Hello students, welcome to a lesson through the virtual training center of the Brihan Mumbai Mahanagarpalika. My name is Shraddha teacher, and in this lockdown period, since we are not able to go to school children, we will be doing many lessons here online through the virtual class. So come on, let's proceed to our lesson for today. So children, let us go to our lesson for today. So it will be a lesson in standard 10th English, and the name of the lesson is Animals, and it is a very beautiful poem from your textbook. Okay, so now in this particular poem you will see children that the poet, he is looking at various qualities of animals, and he is trying to compare them with the qualities in us human beings. Now we know that in this world that the God or the maker has created, we have things which are living things and then things which are non-living things. In the living things, we have plants, we have animals, and we have human beings. Now, human beings and animals, they are similar in many ways, like we have learnt in the younger classes, that we have the same kind of characteristics, that is, we reproduce, we can move from one place to another, we can breathe, we can respire, isn't it? But there are certain qualities which make human beings superior to these animals. But in this particular case, our poet, he believes that he still wants to borrow, or he still wants to, you can say, inculcate certain qualities which are unique to these particular animals of the animal kingdom. So now, what are those qualities, and what, why does he think that animals are much superior to human beings, or the life of animals is not as complicated as the life of human beings? That is what he has tried to explain when he has written this particular poem. So let's go to the poem today. What we will do is, we will, as always, we will read the poem. We will try to get a little bit of information about the poet. Okay, and then we will do some exercises which are part of your textbook. Now, when we look at the exercises which are there in your textbook, children, you will see that there are certain exercises which are part of the warming up activity. That is, they come before the actual poem or before the actual lesson. And then there are some exercises which are part of the English workshop. That is, after you understand the whole lesson, after you understand the meaning of the poem, then you go and try and do those exercises. So let us start first with a warming up activity, and let us do this particular you can say exercise, where we try to compare, or we try to put in place the qualities of animals and the qualities of human beings, and we try and see which quality the animal possesses and which quality is possessed by human beings. And also we will look at certain qualities which are common to both the groups, that is to humans as well as to animals. So you can see here, what is the name of the question? Put the following attributes or abilities given below in the proper circles. So attitudes and abilities, these are different words for qualities. So see here, this is how we can try to develop our vocabulary also. So when there is a particular word which is given in the textbook and you feel that it is a little difficult, what you can do is, you should always keep your dictionary handy. So the dictionary is a very important part of learning English, children. So whenever you have your dictionary with you, if you find a difficult word, you can just look it up in the dictionary. So somewhere or the other in the mind, it is saved. Okay, so now there are so many different qualities, see, right from A up to O. So there is self-control, communicates, love and care, cooks, good manners, has 360 degree vision, shows gratitude, lives for more than 150 years, swims, learns computing, worships God, sleeps in standing position, stands up immediately, brings up children, and belongs to various species after birth. So these are various capabilities, you can say, or various qualities or various attributes. Some of them can be found in humans, some of them you can find only in animals, and certain qualities here you can find in both the groups. So I will try and do a few of the examples with you, and then I will leave it to you to find out the others. Okay, so we are going to do a little bit of self-study here also. I will give you some small assignments. We are not going to do, I will not give you homework at the end of the lesson, but as and when we progress with the lesson, I will keep on giving you small assignments so that you can do it on your own. So let us look at the first quality here, self-control. So this is a quality which I feel is there in human beings. Okay, animals, they do not have this thing called as self-control. Now your ideas and my ideas may differ. Okay, you might feel no, animals can also be controlled, but remember, that is not a natural character. That is something which we do and train the animals. We train the animals to develop self-control. But when you look at animals generally, animals which are living in the wild, animals which are not pet animals, they do not have the quality of self-control. Okay, coming to the next one, quality B, communicates. So what do you think? Do animals communicate and do human beings communicate? So where will you put this? So according to me, communication happens in human beings as well as in animals. Now you will tell me how do animals communicate? See, it is not necessary that you communicate only by speaking. Okay, language as a means of communication is just one of the methods. So there are many other ways in which you can communicate. For example, if an animal looks at you and it growls, it means it is not very happy to see you. Okay, whereas if a animal looks at you and it appears to be friendly, like for example a dog, it looks at you and starts wagging its tail, that means it is communicating that it wants to become your friend. Okay, so I think that communication, or you can say conveying your feelings to others in whichever way, is common to humans as well as to animals. Let us look at the next one, C, love and care. So what do you think? Love and care, it is there in humans as well as it is there in animals also. What about the next one, cooking? What do you think? Do animals cook? Not at all. So cooking is something which only human beings can do, isn't it? Animals, so when we have dogs at home, when we have cats at home, we cook and we feed them. They do not cook on their own. Then let's come to the next one, E, so good manners. So good manners is something which we learn in order to live in society. Okay, to live in a civilized society which has got its own rules. So good manners is something which is a human ability, according to me. Look at the next one, 360 degree vision. This, of course, human beings cannot have. We do not have an eyeball inside our socket which turns 360 degrees. This is something which can be done by animals only. So this is how, children, you will progress. You will look at each of the other attitudes, or you will look at each of the other abilities or qualities, and you will try to figure out whether it is unique to humans, whether it is unique to animals, or whether it is common to both. Okay, so this exercise, like I told you, I'm giving you half of this as an assignment for yourself. So this is one of the activities in your warming up part of the lesson. Let us now talk about the next activity here. Let us try and come to the next activity. So we come across many animals in our vicinity. Vicinity means what? In our area, in the place where we live. We have also read about different animals in books. Now there are some animals which we can see around us. There are some animals which we cannot see around us, but you must have seen these animals either in the pages of a book or on television, okay, on your mobile, etc. So we are trying to make a list of all animals that fall under various categories. So now these animals are also, children, they belong to different categories, isn't it? So you have amphibians, you have mammals, you have wild animals, you have aquatic animals and pet animals. Apart from this also we have insects. Okay, we have various other animals also, but we are looking at only this category which they have given us here. They have asked us to collect as many animals as we can and put them in the proper categories. So one example they've given it to us, see, amphibian. So a frog is an example of an amphibian. A cow is a mammal. In wild animal, we will say lion. Aquatic animals, octopus, and pet animals, cat. Now I need not tell you what is an amphibian, what is a mammal. We already know this. We have learnt it in our science lessons in the other classes. So let us write one set of examples at least. So amphibian. So what is an example of an amphibian, you can say? A salamander is an example of an amphibian. Okay, a salamander is a creature which can live in water as well as it can live on land. And then mammals, may you have an example? Horse, that is, which can give birth to its young ones. Wild animal, let me give you an example here, tiger. Okay, aquatic animal, shark, something which lives in water. And pet animal, dog. All right, so this is a very simple exercise, children. But then you will have to find out at least two sets for me now. So this is an example assignment which I am giving you here. So you will find out at least two sets of animals and add it to this list. So this was one more very simple, very easy, but very interesting activity from your textbook. Now let us go to the main point and let's come to our poem. But before we go to our poem, let's talk about the poet. So our poet who has written this particular lesson, his name is Walt Whitman, and he was an American poet. He was an essayist and he was a journalist. So he used to write poetry, he used to write essays, and he also used to write articles in journals, newspapers, etc. So he was born in 1819. Okay, that is in the 19th century on the 31st of May, and he passed away in 1892 on the 26th of March. So this is all is a little bit of general information about the poet Walt Whitman. Now let us go and let us try to read the poem and also to understand the meanings of certain difficult words in this poem. So this is our poem, children. Before I start, let me tell you that I will try and give you meanings which differ from the meanings which are there in your textbook. In your textbook also, if you see, on the left hand side of the poem, you will see certain words, the meanings are given to you. But I will try and give you meanings which are a little different from those meanings. So you have a bigger vocabulary with you. So I think I could turn and live with animals. They are so placid and self-contained. So here, placid means what? Calm and quiet. Okay, animals, he's saying they are placid and self-contained. Self-contained is a word we have learnt about, or we have heard people saying when it comes to your houses or to your flats. Someone's house is self-contained means it is well equipped and it is self-sufficient. All right, so I, who's this I in the lesson? It is the poet. He thinks that he could live with animals because they are so calm and quiet and they are self-sufficient. It means he thinks that human beings are not calm and quiet and they are not self-sufficient. That is why he wants to turn. That means he wants to leave the way he is living right now and he wants to live with animals. I stand and look at them long and long. They do not sweat and whine about their condition. So he says that I observe them. I stand and look at them long and long means I observe them. And they do not sweat. Sweat means they do not keep on complaining. And they do not whine. Whine means complain. Sweat means keep on bothering and complaining about their condition. So whatever they have, they're happy with it. They do not lie awake in the dark and weep for their sins. They do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. So he's saying that when they feel hungry, they search for food, they eat their food, and then they sleep. So they do not repent, or they do not weep, or they do not feel sorry for the wrong things that they have done. Because according to him, animals do not do things intentionally to hurt others. They do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. He's saying, so they don't keep on discussing things, they just do their duties. Not one is dissatisfied, not one is demented. Demented here means crazy or mad, okay, as the meaning is there in the textbook. So not one is dissatisfied, not one is demented, means not one of them is crazy. The mania of owning things. Mania means madness. So everyone is satisfied with what they have. Alright, you must have seen animals, they don't wear clothes also. So they do not want to have buy a house, they do not want to have buy a car, they do not want to have lots of jewelry, they do not want to buy different clothes. So he's saying that everyone, each and every animal is satisfied with what he or she has. That is the kind of life he wants to live. Our poet Walt Whitman. Let's move on and read the next lines of the poem and try to understand them. Not one kneels to another, nor to his kind that lived thousands of years ago. That means, see, we human beings, what do? Someone is in a higher position, someone is in a lower position. The poor person who's in the lower position, he's always serving the person in the higher position, isn't it? And we also talk about and we also worship ancient kings and queens and people like that. But in animals, this is nothing which happens. So, not one kneels to another, nor to his kind that lived thousands of years ago. Not one is respectable or unhappy over the whole world. So all around the world, all animals are happy, is what he's saying. So they show their relations to me and I accept them. They bring me tokens of myself. They evince them plainly in their possession. Evince means they show or they display. That means whatever qualities an animal has in it, it displays it. Okay, it doesn't keep things hidden from others. So they do not have two faces. One face for showing the public and the other face for showing the real self. I wonder where they get those tokens. Now you have different meanings of tokens. We have learned different meanings of tokens. When you go to visit a temple or when you go to visit a, you can say a place where an amusement park is there, what do? You get tokens, isn't it? So these are not those tokens. These are tokens which are what? Actually their qualities. Did I pass that way huge times ago and negligently drop them? So he's saying, are these qualities something which we human beings had, and somewhere along the way did we drop these qualities and did the animals pick them up? So that is what he wants to say. So children, that was the meaning of the poem for you, the meaning of the new words in the poem, and what the poet Walt Whitman wants to tell us about his thoughts regarding animals. Now, like I told you, after we finish reading the poem and after we finish explaining the poem to you, now I will show you some exercises which are part of your English workshop part. So let's go to some exercises in your English workshop now. So here you're supposed to match the words which are given in table A with their meanings in table B. Now I'm sure it'll be very easy for you since we have already done the poem, we have seen the meanings of the words. So what I suggest is, now this is not an interactive class, children. So I will not be able to ask you questions and wait for you to give me the answers. So what you should do is, when I put a question forth to you like this, you can pause the video and try to figure out the answers and then check the answers with me by playing the video again. So let's look at the words and the meanings. So the first word is wine, and the meaning of wine is complain in an annoying way. That is, if someone goes on complaining and it starts irritating you or it starts making you angry, then that is called as whining. Okay, now sin. Sin means what? It is an offense against a religious or moral law. So when you do something which is not correct and you know it, that whatever you're doing is not correct, but still you commit that offense, you can say, then it is called as a sin. So it could be against a religion or it could be against some moral law. So now moral laws are, children, made in the society so that everyone can have a good life. They are not written anywhere. Okay, look at the next word, evince. So evince means to show. What about mania? Mania could mean a kind of mental illness. And negligent means the remaining meaning, that is failing to take proper care. When you do not care for something properly, it is said that you are neglecting something or you are negligent about something. So this was our first exercise in your English workshop part. Let's move on and let's do some more exercises now. So look here, you have to find adjectives from the poem which refer to positive and negative thinking. So now in this poem, there are certain ideas which are related to positive, you can say, qualities, and certain words which are related to negative attributes or qualities. So you have to pick up some adjectives. Now some examples I will give you, and the remaining you will have to do it as part of your assignment. So let us look at the first positive quality, self-contained. So it is a positive quality, isn't it? You are not dependent on anyone, and you are you think that you are sufficient enough to take care of all your needs. What about negative? Whining is a negative quality. Whining means to keep on complaining in an annoying manner. So whining. Let's look at some more words here. So respectable is a positive thought. And demented is a negative thought. Now the remaining two is homework for you. Okay, so look, go through the entire poem and try to find out one more positive and one more negative word or an adjective. Okay, now what is an adjective? Once again, an adjective is something which describes a noun. Alright, so animals are self-contained, so self-contained animal. A person who keeps on whining, so whining nature. Alright, so we have picked up adjectives which refer to positive and negative thinking. Moving on, you're supposed to complete the following. Here also we will try and do some. So the poet wishes he could turn and live with animals. So this is what he wants to do. He could turn, he wants to turn, and he wants to live with animals. What do animals not complain about? So animals do not complain about their condition or the way they are living their life. Animals do not merely discuss their duty to God. So they just keep on doing things without thinking too much or without discussing. Animals are not crazy about owning things. Okay, so they have no worldly possessions, and they are not interested also in having a long list of worldly possessions. Worldly possession means things like clothes and things like cars or jewelry or money, etc. So this is what we completed from the poem. Let us move on now here. So this is an exercise on true or false. So it is trying to test whether you have understood the meaning of the poem or not. So we will do some together, and the remaining you will do it yourself. So animals are self-reliant. It is a statement which is true. Animals quarrel for their possessions. It is a statement which is false, because animals are not bothered about owning things. They are not crazy about owning things. Animals do not worship other animals is again true. They do not have the idea of God or Baba or Guru or something like that in their community, in the animal community. So these are three answers for you. The remaining three you will try to figure out and write it on your own. So humans have given up many good qualities. Animals suffer humiliation. The poet has retained all his natural virtues. So what have you understood from the poem? You can guess and you can write over here and see whether it is correct or not. All right. Now this is one more, you can say, exercise from your textbook. So you have to read the text again. When you read the text, what will you do? You will try to find out the answers here. So this time when you read the text, you will read it with a purpose. That is, you have to find out and write the answers here. And complete the web, highlighting the good and values and habits which we can learn from the animals. So one is given here, see, they are placid and self-contained. So they are placid means they are calm and quiet and they are self-contained. Now some again I will give you and the others you will search. So the second one is they don't weep for anything. So they don't whine basically. Okay. They don't weep or they don't keep complaining about something. And then you have they are respectable. So a good value in animals. And then you have they are innocent. Okay. So these are the values that we can learn from animals. The remaining two, you can write by reading the text, you can pick up a point from the text, or you can think about your own point. You must have seen animals, you must have observed animals, and some of us are animal lovers also. Okay, so you can think back, you can observe again, and you can write some good quality or habits which we can learn from animals and which we can implement in our lives so that our lives become better. Okay. So these were the exercises from your textbook, children. Now if you look at your textbook, you have certain points where we have to find out certain figures of speech. So let us look at a few figures of speech here now. So the first one is repetition. There are different figures of speech, children, in English, but we are going to talk about only certain ones which are mentioned in this particular poem. So repetition is a figure of speech where you keep on repeating words or lines and phrases over and over again to stress the importance of an idea. So figures of speech, I need not explain what they are. We have been learning them since we were in the 7th and 8th and 9th standard. Okay, so repetition is a figure of speech which appears somewhere in this poem. Let's try to find out where later. So an example of repetition, see, spring is flowers, spring is green grass, and spring is rainy days. So the word spring is repeated. See, now if it was part of prose, the writer would have written spring is flowers, green grass, and rainy days. But since this is a poem, we want to make it more impactful, isn't it? That is why the word spring has been repeated a number of times. So this is an example of repetition. Let us look at one more example of repetition. Mankind must put an end to war, or war will put an end to mankind. So see here, the word mankind is repeated, the word end is repeated, the word war is repeated, the word put is repeated. And this is a very famous saying by President John F. Kennedy, who is an American president. Okay. So these are some examples here of repetition. Let us look at the next figure of speech which has come up in this poem, and it is alliteration. Alliteration means repeated consonant sounds which occur in the beginning of the words or within words. Now when the sounds are repeated at the end of the word, it is called as a rhyme. Okay, in the beginning or somewhere within the word, it is called as alliteration. See, an example is given here. She was wide-eyed and wondering while she waited for Walter to waken. So the word wide-eyed starts with the sound W. Wondering starts with W. While waited, Walter and waken. So these are all sounds of the English letter W. Okay, and it is repeated at the beginning of all these words. That is why this particular figure of speech is called as an alliteration. Okay, and it is the consonant sounds which are repeated, the sounds of the consonants in the alphabet. Okay, let's move on and let's look at one more example. So she sells sea shells by the seashore. So she shells and shore. are examples of alliteration, and cells, sea, and sea are examples of alliteration here. So it doesn't mean that if a word starts with the same letter, they will all sound the same. You can see all the words here, the ones which are highlighted, it's starting with S. But if you catch the ones which are in alliteration, it is the first one she, and then the fourth one shells, and then the last one show. Okay, so this is the meaning and one example of alliteration. I have not taken too many examples because we have already done this before. I'm just brushing up the point for you. The next one is hyperbole. Okay, so hyperbole means a figure of speech in which a lot of exaggeration is used. Exaggeration means, like we say in Hindi, kisi cheez ko bahut bada chada ke bolna. Extreme exaggeration is used. For example, see, I could sleep for a year. Now, this is an exaggeration, children. No one can sleep for a year at a stretch. Maximum, you can sleep for 10 hours or 12 hours. Then automatically, you tend to wake up. Okay? It is a different thing if you have been given some kind of medicines or if someone has made you sleep because of a physical or a health condition. One more example is, this book weighs a ton. So can a book weigh a ton? It is not possible. Maybe a truck could weigh a ton or a train could weigh a ton, but a book cannot weigh a ton. So what do they want to say here? In the first sentence, I could sleep for a year means I could sleep for a long time. I'm feeling very sleepy. And the second one is, this book weighs a ton means it is very heavy actually. The book is very, very heavy. Okay? So these are all examples of hyperbole. See, look here, one more example. She cried so long that she made a lake. So she cried and cried and there were so many tears coming out of her eyes that a lake was formed. So see, it is such a big bada chada ke bolna or such a big exaggeration or hyperbole. We will look at just one more instance of, you can say, figure of speech. Sorry, we have two more. So this is personification. Very simple, very easy. We have seen it a number of times. So giving human qualities to objects or ideas. Personifying something. Okay. Example, the sunlight danced. So can the sunlight dance? No, only human beings can dance. So when we say the sunlight danced, it means we are personifying the sun. And then you have, the streets are calling to me. See, it looks like the streets are calling. The streets cannot call because they do not speak and also because they do not cannot talk. Okay. And the last one is apostrophe. We'll look at some meaning and a few examples and then we will go to our exercises for today. So to speak to a dead or an absent person or to an inanimate object or abstract idea. So when I speak to someone, I expect that person to understand what I'm saying and respond. Okay. But when you speak to someone who's dead, or when you speak to someone who's not there, or when you speak to some object in your house, what will happen? You will not be able to expect any kind of response. But then why do people speak like this to dead people or to absent people or to objects? Just to express their emotions. Okay. So this is an example of apostrophe, and this is the meaning of apostrophe. Now let's come to the exercise for which we have been doing all these explaining part. So you have to find out examples of repetition, alliteration and hyperbole. So let us look at example of repetition first. I stand and look at them long and long. The word long is repeated twice. So it's an example of repetition. Alliteration, they bring me tokens of myself. So bring me tokens of myself. So the word me and myself are in alliteration. The sound m is repeated, the sound of the letter m. Hyperbole, see this, not one is respectable or unhappy over the whole world. So on the whole world, at least there must be one animal which is unhappy. But here the poet is saying there is not a single animal in the whole world which is unhappy on the whole earth. Okay, so these are examples of hyperbole from the poem. You can search for other examples also. Let us look at the last part of the lesson for today. So let us identify the figures of speech in the following lines. I stand and look at them long and long. We just did it. It is an example of repetition. They do not sweat and whine about their condition. It is an example of personification. Otherwise also, animals cannot speak or cannot complain. Okay? They do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. So this is alliteration. D and D is repeated. The sound of the letter D in discussion and D in duty. Now remember children, things like figures of speech like alliteration, you should really look out for them in each question that you get. Alright, because somewhere or the other, invariably a consonant sound will be repeated in a sentence. So if you cannot figure out any other figure of speech, you can write alliteration. You should try to find out but whether the words are in order for alliteration. No one is demented with the mania of owning things. So this is an apostrophe. You're not talking to anyone in particular. Okay, no one you're saying. Or you're talking about animals. They bring me tokens of myself is again alliteration. See, okay, me and myself, and no one is respectable or unhappy over the whole earth. So this is the last part of our lesson where this is an example of hyperbole like we saw previously. So children, wasn't that a wonderful video? And did you enjoy watching it? So if you want to watch more such videos in future, then please like this video and also subscribe to our channel, the MCGM Portal for Education, and also hit the bell button so that you get notified whenever I upload a new video here. Thank you so much for now. Let's meet again soon.